Today, I want to share an example of drawing an interior section while still designing it. In a way, I was still thinking about the design when I started this drawing. I'm going to walk you through some of my thought process, workflow, and techniques that went into sketching this perspective section. If you've been watching my tutorials, drawing over a SketchUp model is a typical process that I go through on most projects that I work on in San Francisco. But if this is your first time on my channel, my name is Henry, and I share drawing and design tips to help architects and interior designers with a digital workflow. I'm using an app called Procreate on my 12.9-inch iPad Pro. Make sure you check out some of my free resources in the link below. They include brushes that I use in all my tutorials, guides on how to draw in scale, and other useful templates to help you draw better and faster. First, loading the SketchUp background that you plan to trace over. We're going to be using the perspective guides in the Drawing Assist feature to help us draw in perspective. What I recently found helpful is to extend the perspective lines from the model until they intersect at a vanishing point. This particular view is a two-point perspective, so there will be two vanishing points. What I actually did was to extend the canvas much further to the left so I can see where my perspective lines converge for one of my vanishing points. When you find both vanishing points, click on the canvas to set the perspective. Now, this doesn't have to be extremely accurate, but you do want to make sure that the perspective lines from your model somewhat matches the perspective guides in the Drawing Assist. Now, you can recrop your canvas from the left since you don't really need all that white space. Before starting the drawing, make sure you have the Drawing Assist toggle on. On a separate layer, let's build a foundation for the drawing first. Idea here is to keep it simple and start with the bigger geometry first. If you've done your perspective guides correctly, you should be able to trace over your model in perspective easily. One way to think of this first layer is a container for all the detail works that will go into it. So don't be itched into drawing the details just yet, as tempting as that might seem. I have to work hard to resist this temptation myself too, but having a systematic layer structure will help you in the long run when you get to editing your work. Another important design element is to clad the entire atrium with vertical wooden slats, which are going to continue from the ground floor to the ceiling and turns into guardrail on the stairs and hallway. To make this experience more dynamic and playful, I introduced multiple openings on different levels so you can actually peek out at different locations around this atrium. If you've been itching to add some details to the drawing, we're finally at a point where we have enough information and we can do this on a new layer. I'm going to start with some bowls and plates on the overhead shelf in the kitchen first, and then a few texture on the kitchen counter and cabinet face, and populating the storage system by the stairs. What I want to communicate for this open display is a mixture of books, artwork, and collectibles in various sizes. The sketch format is fantastic for this because oftentimes you don't know what your clients might like yet. What I'll do for the presentation is to throw in some ideas from other built work as a reference and see if the clients resonate with any of the ideas so I have a better idea when it actually comes down to designing the system in elevation and details. When the composition is about 70 to 80% done like this, you'll see me jump back and forth on different layers to add missing pieces because this isn't a linear process and I don't want to prescribe an exact order for you either. But the guidelines I'm giving you here so far should give you a good framework if you don't know where to start. Here, I'm going to thicken my cut lines so my line weights have some hierarchy to it, which is going to help with legibility, and add some texture to the floor and a pendant over the kitchen island. As good practice, I will always rename and group my layers before getting into coloring. One of the secrets behind coloring is to have a good brush to begin with. I use a custom brush that mimics the traditional Copic marker, which you can find in the links below. You just need to find the right color to start, but even if you don't, you can always adjust the hue, saturation, and brightness later on. I like to start with a color that has the biggest area, and in this case, it's the wood for the storage wall and all the slats. Then I create a new layer for the backside of the storage system to be orange. This might not make sense to you, but this color mirrors what we have on the exterior of the building, but it's strong way too saturated to begin with, but I can dial that down using the hue saturation tool. The floor color is on a separate layer just in case I want to tweak that color independent from the rest. This principle should apply to any materials that you're not sure of. On another new layer, I colored in all the display items. Even though there are many different colors, I did this all in a single layer as a way just to capture it all. In general, I like to use a mix of earthy tones in my color palette, nothing overly bright or crazy neon. I guess this is a personal choice, but if you want to use the same color palette as me, you can download my swatches directly into Procreate. The last color layers that I created for this is for the wall poche. Something dark and black will do with a larger brush. When the drawing is all done, now I'm going to add in my special paper texture. To do this, I'm going to insert the file from iCloud on the iPad, change the blend mode from normal to overlay. The original file has a beigey tone to it, so I'm going to desaturate it first to make it monochromatic, then go to my curve adjustment and take that curve downwards just a little bit so that there's a little bit more contrast to the paper texture. At this point, I'll take a little break and come back in an hour or in a day to edit the design even more. And I strongly recommend this because sometimes you get really tunnel vision when drawing so close to the iPad, and when you come back, you might actually discover something glaringly wrong. If you enjoyed this video, drop a like or a comment and let me know which part that you found most useful in. And if there's anything that's confusing, let me know as well. Thanks. Bye.